Welcome to ZARM, the Center of Applied Space Technology and Microgravity. We are the operator of the biggest microgravity lab in Europe, and our customers come from all over the world to conduct their microgravity experiments here. My name is Jasmin, and today we are going to check out the research that happens right here at ZARM. And in order to do that, we are meeting my colleague Sven Herrman. Hello, Sven.
Hi, Jasmin.
Sven is heading a research group called Experimental Gravitation and Quantum Optics. Sven, tell us about your work.
In my research group, we study the physics of ultra-cold atoms and quantum gases, particularly in microgravity. For example, we try to use them in tests of fundamental physics, but we're also investigating how they could be used in applications of quantum sensing.
So, I have heard that you and your team managed to reach a really, really low temperature in one of your projects. What was that about?
Yes, that is true. That is the QUANTUS 2 project, actually. And this is a collaborative project we have with a couple of other universities. And in this experiment, we obtained a record temperature of 38 picokelvins here in the drop tower. And what we're talking about here is then really just a tiny ensemble, a tiny cloud of atoms, about 100,000 rubidium atoms that we cool down. That means that all these atoms go to one ground state, the so-called Bose-Einstein condensate. And in that state, they form coherent matter wave. Now, this was actually only a byproduct to achieve this very, very cold temperature, because what we're interested in is to really slow down the atoms so that this tiny cloud of atoms does not expand too much when we use it in our interferometer in the drop tower. And slowing down means really cooling it down to this very low temperature. The 38 picokelvins means that on average the atoms in this cloud move with only 50 micrometers per second or so. And that's what we are actually interested in.
So, it's about the state of the atoms, not so much about the temperature. But what is a Bose-Einstein condensate actually?
Imagine you have a gas at room temperature, just like the surrounding air here. All the particles at room temperature, they move at relatively high speeds, something on the order of 300 meters per second. Now, if you cool this gas down, essentially means you will slow down the movement of the atoms. Now you can imagine that all these atoms, all these particles, they have a quantum mechanical wavelength attached to them. That's the so-called de Broglie wavelength. And this is a function of temperature. The colder you get, the larger this de Broglie wavelength will get. And then all these increasing quantum wave packets, let's say, will overlap and will form a coherent matter wave. And that's when we arrive at the Bose-Einstein condensate, at the level of something like 100 nanokelvins in temperature.
Okay, that sounds kind of technically demanding. How do you do that?
So to arrive at these really low temperatures, what we usually do, or what we do in this experiment, is we use a two-step cooling process, basically. The first step is laser cooling in a so-called magneto-optical chip trap. So that's a combination of lasers and magnetic potentials, where we cool down to something on the order of 10, 20 microkelvins, about 10 to the 8 atoms. And we cannot go any further if we use lasers, because we always have the recoil of the photons with the atoms that will prevent us from getting any lower. So to go down to Bose-Einstein condensate in 100 nanokelvins, we use evaporation cooling as a second step. And that means we load all these atoms then into a purely magnetic trap on our atom chip. And then we will evaporate the hot atoms out of this trap so that only the cold atoms remain and rethermalize. And with that, we lose a lot of atoms, but we also reduce the temperature by orders of magnitude. And it's kind of comparable in principle like the evaporation cooling that takes place in your coffee cup, yeah, where you also have the hot coffee atoms leaving the cup and the rest of the coffee settles down at a lower temperature. Just here, we do it much more efficiently and much quicker.
Ah, cool. But as you and your team put all of this into one of our drop capsules, I guess you must be quite into weightlessness too?
So the Bose-Einstein condensates I just described, we want to use them in matter wave interferometers. And the sensitivity of these matter wave interferometers increases a lot the more time the atoms can spend in this matter wave interferometer. Now, in the matter wave interferometer, we cannot suspend the atoms. We cannot hold them. We have to let them freely fall. And that limits the time they spend in the interferometer. In an apparatus here in the laboratory, just to 100 milliseconds or something. And that's why we set up everything in a drop capsule, and we can go then to the catapult, to the drop tower, and we can increase this free fall time up to 9.3 seconds. And that tremendously can increase the sensitivity of these instruments, particularly since the sensitivity scales quadratically with the freefall time.
Okay, so if I understand you correctly, in normal gravity, the atoms would just fall to the ground shortly after you turned off the trap, but not in weightlessness, which is why you can observe the Bose-Einstein condensate for much longer. Still, I am asking myself, what are they good for in the end?
Yeah, these matter wave interferometers, they have a lot of interesting applications. So one of our main motivations is doing research in fundamental physics. But there's also some recent proposals, actually, or investigations that look at applications in Earth observation and geodesy. These matter waves, they are sensitive to gravity. That means you can detect really tiny variations in Earth's gravity field. And this you can use in mobile devices in exploration, but also in satellite missions that do Earth observation. And that, of course, then can help to monitor the consequences of climate change, the melting of glaciers, the changes in ground level, water supplies and everything. So that is maybe a long-term goal of these things.
So in the future, we will be able to detect the slightest gravitational changes. And with that, we could not only observe our own planet Earth on a whole new level, but even foreign planets? Sven, I am impressed. Thank you very much.
Yeah, you're welcome.